for one.
Okay, welcome everyone. So today what we're going to be talking about is solubility product constant, otherwise known as KSP, and working on KSP calculations. So we already started this. So right now what we're going to do is I'm going to give you a quick little overview of what KSP is. What is solubility product? What is solubility versus what is the solubility product constant? Because they are two different things. So we're going to talk a little bit about that. What I've got here is I've got a FET simulation. This is an awesome simulation. And basically, this is showing a substance that we would call insoluble. And so when we talk about solubility, we're talking about how much something dissolves, but not really. Remember, we broke it down a little bit more to does it what or not? Break up into?
Ions.
Awesome. Does it break up into ions? So does it dissociate? Does it dissociate? Remember, what we're talking about in K is we're talking about taking your reactants and turning them into products. And if you get a K that's bigger than 1, it favors the products. If you get a K less than 1, then what does that mean? It favors the reactants. And so what we do is we take a look at our equation, and in this case here, what we're going to be talking about is a substance that is going to be ionizing, and so your reactant is a solid, and then you've got ions, okay? We don't typically talk about the KSP for a substance that does ionize regularly, like NaCl, completely ionizes, so that when you drop NaCl into water, salt in the water, it is going to completely break up, and this you will not have left over anymore. So this 1 molar will end up turning into 0 molar, and the Na plus and the Cl minus will completely be 1 molar. So this is actually going to be 0 once you reach equilibrium, okay? Same thing for something like Na2CO3. Yes, you have 1 molar of it in the beginning, but then what's going to happen is this will be all gone once it reaches equilibrium. You'll have 0 of this, 2 molar of this, and 1 molar of this because of your ratios. So that's a 1-to-2 ratio, and that's a 1-to-1 ratio. So we're going to come back to this idea at the very end of these notes too. So we'll talk about what happens when you add a common ion to a solution that has already reached equilibrium. So this KSP, we said that we ignore solids and liquids. So if we're ignoring solids and liquids, that means that the K is simply equal to the concentration of what? The products. Because if your reactant is a solid, so if we take a look at AgCl, if your reactant is a solid, then when you write your KSP expression, it's just going to be the concentration of your two products. And since this breaks up into 1-to-1 ratio, then that's X, and that's X as well. And so you could call that X squared if you don't have any values. And you could either be solving for the K, or you can be solving for the solubility, or you can be solving for the concentration of each ion. So let's talk about that for just a second, okay? So solubility is exactly what it sounds like, how much of it dissolves or really, in our case, dissociates and breaks up into ions. So when they say what's the solubility, they're typically going to be talking about the substance that is dissolving. That's what they're going to be talking about, the solubility of it. But if you know how much broke up, then these two should be equal, not the concentration of it. Concentration of it originally could be different, okay? What we're talking about is not what is the original concentration. So if we take a look at this simulation, you can have an initial concentration of the substance. What we're talking about is how much of it dissociated. So we don't want to know this part here. We just want to know how much of it is ionizing. That's what we're calling the solubility of it, okay? And if you know what your concentration is of either of the ions, then you can use your stoichiometric, your ratio, and the moles between them to be able to figure out how much dissolved. Does that make sense? Okay, so that's basically what we're looking at when we're talking about solubility. Again, KSP is different. How do we know it's different? Well, first of all, what are the units of K? There are no units. No units for this K, okay? So in solubility, you could say how many moles of solute per liter, or it can be grams per liter. It could be grams per milliliter. So you can have different units when you're talking about how much something dissolves in something else. But when you're talking about KSP, KSP is not going to have a unit. Again, if it's greater than 1, it favors products. And in this case, our products are ions, aqueous ions, and if your number is less than 1, then it's going to favor reactants. And these numbers are going to be very, very small. Like a very common KSP value would be 10 to the negative 10th, 10 to the negative 8th, We can see here, we're looking at calcium fluoride, and this is 10 to the negative 11th. Okay, we've got 10 to the negative 11th for the KSP value. So those are very common, very, again, very, very small numbers, less than one, which means that they're favoring the reactants. As long as you have that in your mind too, this is really gonna help. So conceptually understanding what is going on with solubility is gonna make a big difference. This problem was a little bit different from this one up here, where here we were being asked what the concentration was of the Ag plus and the Cl minus, which would be the same as the solubility for the AgCl. So really, this is also equal to the solubility of AgCl. So it is the concentration of the Ag plus, it is the concentration of the Cl minus, it's not the concentration of the AgCl. It's the solubility of the AgCl, again, because the AgCl is gonna break up. We're not talking about how much of it stuck together, we're talking about how much of it broke up. So as long as we know how much of either ion we have, again, our ratio is 1:1. In this problem, they were asking us for the solubility of the CaF2. So we did the SIT problem the same exact way, except it was a 1:2 ratio. So if you don't have a value, and you can call this one X, what would this one be? 2X, and again, that just comes from your ratio. Okay, so if this is X, then that would be called 2X. So when you go to find the solubility of this, once you find what X is equal to, you can see that this is the same ratio as this. So if that's X, this would also be X. Again, it's not the concentration. We would call that the... Say it louder. Solubility. Awesome. That would be the solubility of the calcium fluoride, okay? Or how much of it is dissociating. And what we talked about was I asked for it in molarity or grams per liter. So depending on what you need, you could switch molarity. And so you could switch your molarity to moles over liters and then just switch your moles to grams using the molar mass. So if you did need to switch it into grams per liter, that's all you would need to do. Okay. So now let's take a look at some new problems here. So this next problem is saying that the solubility of PbIO32 is 0.0024224 grams per liter, and they're asking us to find the KSP for it. First step in any equilibrium problem, first step is, one, make sure you have an equation, a balanced equation, and two, write your, do you remember what we call it? The expression, okay? You want to write your equilibrium expression. So those two things you need to do right away. We don't have a balanced equation, so what do we do first? Write the equation. So we've got PbIO32, and this is solid right now, and it's going to break up and form what? Pb2 plus and 2IO3 minuses. Okay, so now let's write our KSP expression. So KSP is equal to concentration of what in this case? Only the product. So I've got my Pb2 plus times my IO3 minus, but what do I need? Squared. Awesome. So we need to make sure that we square it because of this 2 in front there. Okay? And then we're looking for the KSP here. So I know that the solubility of PbIO32, the solubility of this, is 0.0224 grams per liter, which is okay, but what do I need to do? What do I need to change this to? Molarity. Perfect. Okay? So what we're going to do is we're going to switch this first. So I've got 0.0224 grams per liter. And I put over here that I already added it up. The molar mass of it is 557.0 grams per mole. So we're just going to divide this, 0.0224 divided by the 557. Okay, so we're getting 4.02 times 10 to the negative 5, and now we're in molarity. Again, this is not the concentration of the PbIO32. This is the solubility of the PbIO32, which means what? How much of it is dissociating, okay? So we've said it a few times already because this really is important that you understand conceptually what's happening here. So I'm going to switch this and make it 4.02 times 10 to the negative 5 molar, which means how much of this actually do I have inside of my flask? 4.02 times 10 to the negative 5 molar. And what about this one? Double it, which means 8.04 times 10 to the negative 5 molar. Okay, so that's double that because of your 2 right there, the ratio of 2. Okay, so now we have everything we need in order to plug into here. So my KSP is equal to the lead ion concentration, which is the 4.02 times 10 to the negative 5, And my IL-3 is 8.04 times 10 to the negative 5, but what do we need to do that one? Square it. And so let's figure out what this is. What is it? 2.6 times 10 to the negative 13. Mm-hmm. And we've got three sig figs. So is it 2.60?
Yep.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Times 10 to the negative 13. And what are my units?
No
units. It's K. All right? So what does this tell us? This 10 to the negative 13 is telling us that it's really favoring what? The reactants, which are a solid, which means it's not really breaking up very much. Okay? All right, so let's try this next one. By the way, I want you to pay attention to this because we're going to come to a problem a little bit later. I want you to pay attention that this is double this, but once you have the concentration of it, you are not going to double it again. So this next problem that we have here, they're giving us the KSP. This is an easy problem. This is the same as some of the problems that we were doing on the page before. It's asking us what is the solubility of the BaCO3 in pure water. Okay. What's step one again? We always need to do two things before we start any of these problems. Step one is balance equation and expression. Perfect. Balance equation, expression. So let's write our balance equation. I've got BaCO3, and that's going to dissociate and make Ba2+ and CO3 2-. And this is starting off as a solid. And now let's write our expression. So I've got KSP is equal to, again, what do we say? It's only equal to concentration of the products. So Ba2+ and CO3 2-. They're giving us the KSP value, so I know that it's 8.1 times 10 to the negative 8. They are not telling us anything else. What do you do when you don't have anything else? Use X. Awesome. We're going to use X. And if you call this X and you call this X, what would this be? X. Awesome. There's a 1:1:1 ratio, so those are all going to be X. So this must be x times x, which means I heard it before, it would be x squared. Awesome. How do you solve for x squared, everybody?
Square root.
Square root and square root. And so if you can tell me what 2.85 x...
2.85 times 10 to the negative 4.
So let's go with 2.9. Would it be 2.8 or 2.9 then?
2.8.
2.8 times 10 to the...
Negative 4.
And what are my units now? Molarity. Perfect. This is molarity. Okay. So this is equal to the concentration of my Ba2+, which is equal to the concentration of my CO3 2-. It's also equal to the solubility of BaCO3. Okay, so those are all going to be equal to each other. All right, now watch what happens here. Okay, so we're going to shift gears a little bit here. It says, what is the solubility of barium carbonate in a 0.15 Na2CO3 solution? Okay. So we know that Na2CO3 is going to break up. And by the way, you wouldn't necessarily need this, okay, this piece of it. All you would need to know is you're going to see one particular ion that you would need. You'll see in a second here. What is this going to break up into? 2Na+ and CO3 2-. Awesome. Okay, I have 0.15 molar of this. 0.15 molar of this. What do you know about sodium compounds? What do you know about the alkali metals? They're all soluble. Perfect. They're all soluble, which means this is completely going to break apart. Okay? This is completely going to break apart. So once it reaches equilibrium, how much of this am I going to have?
Zero.
How much of this will you have?
0.3
and 0.15. Awesome. So this I'm going to do double. So this one's going to be 0.30, and this is going to be 0.15 molar. Okay? And this is going to go down to 0 molar. Now, if you did, because in the book they do this a little bit differently, they show you how you can use an ice box for this. So you don't have to, again, but what you would do is you would say that this is 0.15 molar, and this to start is 0 molar, and this is 0 molar. And then you would say your change step would be that this is going to be all gone. So this is going to be minus 0.15, which means this is plus 0.30, because it's times 2. Remember, your change step is where the stoichiometry works, and this would be a 0.15 molar. And then all you would do is 0.15 minus 0.15 is 0. Then this is 0.30, and this is 0.15. Okay? So you can work out an ice box. That's the way that the textbook wants you to do it. But really, we wouldn't even have to show any of this. I'll show you why once we come to the next part of the problem. So right now what we have is our 0.15 is 0, this is 0.30, and this is 0.15. Okay. So now what we're going to do is we know that this is what's happening with the sodium carbonate, but they're asking us what the solubility of BaCO3 is. So what are we actually writing our expression for? Because that's that we don't need an expression for that. We're going to write our expression for the BaCO3. So what I'm going to do is, I know it's right up here, but I'm going to rewrite the equation and the expression for this problem. Typically, this problem would not be given to you, okay? You would just be doing this, you'd be given the KSB, and you would just be given this problem, okay? So let's write our BaCO3 is going to break up into Ba2 plus and CO3 2 minus. And then I'm going to leave a little bit of space just in case I need to write some things down here. My KSB, my expression, is equal to, again, the Ba2 plus times the CO3 2 minus. And I know my KSP is 8.1 times 10 to the negative 8. I know that that's my KSP value. Okay. So let's imagine that we had a flask. And I know that the BaCO3 is 0.00028 is how much of it is going to be dissociating. So I know that my BaCO3 is mostly going to be solid down here on the bottom. So I'm just going to write a bunch of BaCO3s down here on the bottom of my flask. Okay, I've got a bunch of BaCO3s. And then I'm going to draw a couple of them dissociated. So assuming this is aqueous solution in water, so I'm going to draw a couple of them in here, Ba2 plus and CO3 2 minus, a couple of them dissociating. Okay, and now I actually have this in a sodium carbonate solution. And we know that sodium carbonate completely ionizes and dissociates. So I'm just going to write a bunch of Na, here's Na plus, another Na plus, because it's two of them for every one, CO3 2 minus, Na plus, CO3 2 minus, let's do one more, Na plus, and CO3 2 minus. Your flask and the ions inside, there's no way of distinguishing which CO3 2 minus comes from the Na plus and which CO3 2 minus comes from the barium carbonate. Do you agree? Okay? There's no difference. An ion is an ion. It's either carbonate or it's not carbonate. Okay? So there's no way of being able to distinguish between it. But we know that barium carbonate likes to come together. So barium ions and carbonate ions like to come together to form barium carbonate until they reach some equilibrium. So we know that these two are going to want to come together, okay? So the barium is going to actually draw up carbonates inside of your solution, which means that what about the sodium ion? Is the sodium ion going to do anything in your solution besides being a spectator? Nope, it's just going to sit around and it's just going to watch. It's going to just sit around and watch as a spectator. But this carbonate ion, the carbonate ion is going to play a part in this, okay? So what we're going to do is we're going to actually add that to the carbonate ion concentration because it can't tell, your solution can't tell which one came from sodium carbonate and which one came from barium carbonate. Okay, it's just extra carbonate that's inside of your solution. So I don't have values for any of these. So again, if I don't have a value, I'm going to call it X. And that means that this is X. But this isn't just X. It's x plus 0.15. Awesome. It is x plus 0.15. Can you tell me something about 0.00028 plus 0.15? Oops. Plus 0.15. If you were to answer this significantly, what happens? Your answer is 0.15. Which means this is insignificant. This here is insignificant. Now, it's not exactly this number anyway. I'm saying it's about this, okay? It's gonna be around there. We know that the solubility of it is going to be very low, so this is gonna be insignificant, which means, because I don't know X, I'm trying to find X, okay? This isn't exactly what it is because I've changed my parameters here, but I know that it's going to be something in this arena. So instead of calling this x plus 0.1, we could work out the algebra that way, okay? But what's a lot easier is to say that this is approximately equal to 0.15. Awesome. So I'm going to make this approximately equal to 0.15 molar. All right? Because of this. Because we're going to say that 0.00028 is insignificant. Remember, when you add and subtract, the rules are different. When you add and subtract, you would stop wherever your greatest estimated digit is. So there's an estimated digit, there's an estimated digit. That's my greatest place for my estimated digit. It can't be any better than that, okay? So now I'm gonna plug in my values. Barium ion is X, and carbonate is X plus 0.15, which we're just gonna call 0.15 molar. So how do I solve for X? Divide by 0.15, and if we divide this by 0.15, perfect. So we're getting 5.4 e negative 7, you said? 5.4 times 10 to the negative 7. And this is molarity, right? This is going to be the concentration of it. So I want to know the solubility of barium carbonate. So what does that match? Is that X?
Yeah.
Yes. If this is X, this is X because it's a 1-to-1 ratio. So then this is equal to the solubility of BaCO3. Okay? All right, one more problem here. And this question is, will it precipitate? So the very first thing that we want to make sure that we talk about is if you have some compound, XY, and it's a solid, and your compound is going to dissociate and form X plus and Y minus, let's say, okay? If we look at this, and we're going to reintroduce Q again because we need to remember what Q is. What we said was, if K is greater than 1, then K is greater than 1 means you're favoring the products, and so you would have more of these. If K is less than 1, you're going to be favoring your reactants, and you would have more of the solid inside of the solution. What's Q? Well, Q is called the reaction quotient. Remember, we use Q when you just throw in, what do we say starts with an R? Random concentrations, yes? It's an easier word than anything, right? It's just a random concentration, okay? Anytime that you throw in random pressure values into a system or random concentration values into a system, we're not at equilibrium yet, then we're gonna call that Q, the reaction quotient. So what we had said was if Q and K were equal to each other, that means you're already at equilibrium. If Q is greater than K, you have surpassed equilibrium. You have too many what? Products. What does your reaction need to do? Shift backwards and favor the reactants. It's going to favor the reactants until it comes back to equilibrium. Okay. If Q is less than K, you haven't reached equilibrium yet, so your reaction is going to favor the products. Well, in this case, our products are ions. If you favor the products, you are going to favor the making of ions. If you favor the reactants, you are going to favor the making of a
solid,
which we would call a precipitate. Okay. So the question is basically going to ask us to compare Q and K. So you're going to see in just a second here. It says, would you expect to produce a precipitate if you mix 100 mL of this lead nitrate solution with 300 mL of this sodium chloride solution? And then they're giving us, and I want you to circle this, they're giving us the KSP for PbCl2. They're giving us the KSP for PbCl2 for a reason. They're not giving us the KSP for NaCl. Guess why they're not giving us the KSP for NaCl? It would be huge. It would be completely dissociated, and it would be huge, okay? That's going to be a huge number, and it's going to be way far to the right. NaCl is going to all break up into its ions, so you're not going to have a K value in a sense. It's going to be way too big. So we don't write KSP values or K values, when KSP values specifically, when it's that far to the right. So we're also not giving it for lead nitrate. Guess what do you know about nitrates? Yep, they're all soluble. Nitrates are all soluble as well. So the first thing I want you to do, which you don't have to do in a problem like this, the first thing that we're going to do is we're going to write the balanced equation for this just to get an idea of where we are, okay? But this really is not necessary. This part is not necessary. We're going to write our balanced equation. So I've got PbNO32 is going to react with NaCl. And what's going to happen? What kind of reaction is this? Double displacement. So I'm going to get Pb with Cl. So I'm going to get PbCl2. And then I'm going to get NaNO3. Na plus and NO3 minus. And then we balance it. And I've got 2 in front of my NO3 minus, which makes it 2 NaCls. Okay, and so this is my balanced equation. Is this going to form a precipitate? No. So this is the one that we are concerned about, is the PbCl2, which is why they gave us the KSP for PbCl2. Okay? So, what's the first step in any one of these problems, everybody? Write your balanced equation and write the expression. Okay? So in order to do the expression, I need my equation first. So I'm going to write PbCl2 solid, and my arrow, I've got Pb2 plus, plus 2 Cl minuses. And now my expression is KSP is equal to my lead ion concentration and the Cl minus concentration squared. Okay, so I know my KSP value. I know that my KSP is equal to 1.62 times 10 to the negative 5. Let's hold off for just a second here, okay? So I'm going to draw a little bit of a squiggly line over here so that we can get something else going on the other side here. So here I have volume and the molarity of this lead nitrate, okay? And I know that my moles of my lead nitrate will remain the same inside of my solution. But once I add the volume, I change my volume, what happens to molarity? Well, molarity changes. Why? Because what are the units of molarity? Moles over liters. And if you change your liters, you keep your moles the same, but your liters change, you're going to have to recalculate a new molarity. Okay? Let's get an idea of where we're going here. Okay? So the first thing is, I know that I am reacting these two to form these two right here. Okay? And I'm trying to figure out my concentration of the lead and the chloride. I know by the law of conservation of matter and mass that the amount of lead that I have here should be the same as the lead here. And the amount of chloride ion that I have here should be the same as the chloride here. So if I can figure out my lead ion concentration here, then I should be able to plug it in here because there's nothing else to change it. Okay? So what I'm going to do is let's first figure out my lead ion concentration. So like we said, if you know the molarity initially, but you've changed your volume, it's almost like a dilution. And what equation do you remember when we used dilutions, when we were trying to calculate dilutions? M1V1 equals M2V2. So what we're going to do is we're going to rearrange this to solve for M2. Okay? We want to know our new concentration after we've changed our volume. So we're going to do M2 is equal to M1V1 over V2, and V2 is going to be our new total volume. Okay? V2 is going to be your new total volume, and anytime you change the volume, you can always figure out the new molarity simply by using your dilution equation. Okay? So our lead ion, we know that we've got a 0.025 molar concentration, and we know the volume of it. I could switch to liters, but since this is a ratio, I'm dividing by milliliters anyway, so what happens? Yep, it's the same, they cancel out. So it's fine anyway. So I can just keep it in milliliters. What is my new total volume? 400 mils. Awesome. It's 100 here plus 300 here, which is going to give us 400 mils total. So this is our new volume. Okay, so let's figure out what we have here. Anyone calculate it yet? 0.0063, or I'm going to go with 625. I think I should have used one other sig fig. Is that 0.00?
Yeah.
No? Okay. And this is our molarity, and this is the lead ion concentration. That's a lead ion molarity. So we're going to do the same thing for the chloride ion, for our Cl minus. Okay. So chloride, I've got 300 mils of a 0.015. Again, I should have added another sig fig in there to make that three sig figs. 0.0150 molar, and we've got 300 mils of this. Again, what's our new total volume? 400. We've mixed these two together. Our new volume is now 400 mils. So let's figure this out.
0.0113.
You're getting 0.01125 or 0.0. Okay. So 0.0113. Awesome. And that's our Cl minus ion concentration. Okay, this is the concentration. This is what it is. You cannot change the concentration. It's like the law of conservation of mass. If you said that you have 4 grams, even if it's a ratio of 2 on the other side, you still have 4 grams. You can't change that, right? So what you have on your reactant side is what you have on the product side. So I want to make sure that you keep that in mind. So my live concentration here, if I go to plug this in, I cannot call this K. Why not? It's random. Did it say that we were at equilibrium? We're not at equilibrium. If you're not at equilibrium, you don't use K. What do you use?
Q.
Q. Awesome. Okay? So what we're going to do is we're going to solve, instead of this, we're going to solve for Q. So Q is equal to, same thing though, right? Our expression is still the same for Q. It's just that we're plugging in random concentrations. I've got 0.00625 molar on my lead ion concentration. My chloride ion concentration is 0.0113 molar, but we have to square that. We do have to square it. And so we get that Q is equal to 7.91 times 10 to the negative 7. Units. No units. Okay. This is Q. This is K. Here's my K. Here's my Q. Which one's bigger?
K.
Q is less than K. Q is less than K. If Q is less than K, then remember your reaction has not reached equilibrium yet. What do you have to do?
Favor the products.
That means it's going to keep on moving toward the products. Therefore, it favors the products. And if it favors the products, are the products a solid or aqueous?
Aqueous.
So do we make a precipitate?
Nope.
No. The precipitate is a reactant, so no PPT. No precipitate in this case. If you're favoring the reactants, you would say, yes, there's a precipitate. If you're favoring the products, you would say, no precipitate. Let's just recap this problem here. It seems like it's super, super long, okay? The first thing that you need to do is you need to check to see, write your expression, and write, really, that's always the first thing you do. Write your equation and write your expression and find out what it is that could be your precipitate. They have to give you the KSP for it, okay? Then what you're going to do is you're going to find your new concentration once you've changed your volumes. You're going to find your new concentration. Once you have that, calculate your Q and compare Q to K. If it favors the products, that's aqueous, those are ions. If it favors the reactants, those are going to be, that's going to be a solid precipitate. You would say, yes, it precipitates. All right, and that's it. That's a wrap for KSP and doing solubility product constant. Happy day, everybody.